I don't know how to swim. I'm afraid of the water. So I decided to overcome my fear by scuba diving. I would have an oxygen tank on my back. What could possibly go wrong? In fact, it went extremely well. Well, that is a blatant lie. It was a disaster. My wetsuit was too big, so even when I peed in it, the water was still flowing and it was very cold. My breathing was too fast. I was afraid. I was panicking. I could not breathe anymore. And I was asking myself at that point, what was going on? And then I saw a fish. It was getting closer. I could identify it, so I thought to myself, well, it's good that I'm a marine biologist. At least I could recognize this as a grouper fish minutes before I'd die. Knowledgeable. We are expected as marine biologists to know how to swim, but when you grow up far from the privilege of the sea, you are at a disadvantage. I was always perceived as different, and I was put aside. Even today, I am racialized. But I would say I am here today because I bank on that difference and what it could bring. Imagine a world where that difference means leadership. Imagine a world where a little kid from an African village who walked miles to find water and did not know how to swim becomes a prominent marine biologist. Today, I am proud to be that kid. And a little confession, I still don't know how to swim. My name is Dihia Belhabib, and I'm the Chief Scientific Officer for Shackleton 2022. I am a Principal Investigator on Fisheries at Ecotrust Canada, and I'm also an environmental defender inventing technologies to protect the ocean and its people. I grew up in a very conservative village of Algeria, where I was expected to become a teacher, a doctor, or a housewife. Instead, I went out on a boat with 40 men, well, to sample plankton. It was very exciting to become a scientist in an era and a space where women were slaughtered for being women. People often tell me I don't look like a scientist, and well, I do ask myself the question, what does really a scientist look like? And for once, we know what Google thinks scientists looked like in the 19th century. And you know what? Google is always right, except when you Google I have a headache, I don't guarantee that you would like the results. In contrast, this is what a scientist looks like today. But while we aspire for more diversity in science, there are still major gaps. In scientific research, you see, we use peer-reviewed publications as a proxy for academic prestige and funding and success and resources. Did you know that over a quarter of all peer-reviewed publications in the world are by scholars in the United States and Europe alone? It is not always about capacity, as we call it, capacity building or individual capacity, or training for that matter. It is also about fair access to funding. Oftentimes, funding is not accessible to what we call minorities in science, because science, despite our greatest efforts, has been racialized for so long. So let's go back in time a little bit. Racialized views on science and its history are common. We are taught in schools that science has emerged in Europe, while what we consider as modern scientific methods have in fact developed in China, the Islamic world, the indigenous peoples of the Americas, and Africa, thanks to observation, classification, and experimentation skills. But this is history, and while we need to acknowledge and recognize these contributions to science then, what happens today? A few months ago, Dr. Aileen Owimana and her team in Rwanda, one of the countries in Africa that suffer from a prevalence of malaria, have discovered a mutation of the parasite that causes malaria that is resistant to artemisinin in 7.4% of the patient they had monitored. This form of resistance is well known in Southeast Asia, but this is the first time resistance to this particular medicine is discovered on the African continent, where 90% of malarial cases are found. Now, cure rates in Rwanda are at 95%. It's pretty high, or more. But this form of resistance could reduce the success rate of the anti-malarial chemotherapy in Africa. Well, I wish I had a happier ending to this story, but bear with me for a second. What if it had not been discovered? What if Dr. Uwimana and her team did not have the resources to study and discover this form of resistance? We could easily go back to millions of children dying from malaria on the continent, just like in the 1980s. Countries near the equator are in fact not only affected by diseases such as malaria, but they are the ones most affected by the impacts of climate change. What's the relationship, you would ask? Well, in fact, we know today that climate change and hence future climate might become more suitable for malarial transmission, especially in tropical regions. Climate change and the science of it are also about simple things. Simple things like soil quality, sanitation, and as simple as the way you cook. See, African farmers are experiencing increased soil degradation, inadequate sanitation, and a lack of access to proper energy to simply cook. Lack of sanitation kills 700,000 children a year from diarrhea, and the use of solid fuels for cooking, such as charcoal, for example, causes 4.3 million premature deaths a year, according to the World Health Organization. These issues occur typically within those tropical regions of the world, in this particular case, African regions. So, empowered by the willingness to change things, African engineers from Uganda have introduced one simple scientific concept of clean energy because themselves have lived and had experienced and observed and knew of all those issues firsthand. It's a toilet, a simple toilet, but a toilet that can recycle human excrements to make a safe soil fertilizer and combustible biogas that can be used for household needs such as cooking. So empowering these researchers, scholars, engineers early on can have major repercussions on saving lives and adapting to the impacts of climate change. It is not, unfortunately, only about the land. Changes are also happening in the greatest lungs of the planet, the ocean. Take fish, for example. In a changing climate and warming waters, the oceans will experience local extinctions and local invasions of fish. Fish are going to migrate away from tropical countries near the equator towards the northern or southern countries where the waters are more within their range of temperature now that it is too warm for them within their own usual habitat. Arctic countries, for example, such as Canada and others, are projected to see 40% increase in their fish catches by 2050. While fishers in West Africa will see their income decline to less than $10 a day, and that's if they're lucky. See, this is yet another example of how global inequality has worsened under climate change, and the GDP in lower income countries has further declined. So people end up having less resources. They become poorer. And that isn't fair, is it? People experience more droughts, more climatic events, more erosion and sea level rise, and more diseases, malaria, Ebola, and so on and so forth. Even the oceans lose life as fish moves away towards higher income countries. That little kid from the bushes of Africa, that little girl from Trinidad, and that woman from Fiji are all experts in the impacts of climate change. By bringing everyone to the table, we bring in more expertise, more knowledge, more diversity, and better solutions to regreen our planet. The ocean is not only the lungs of the planet, it's also its thermometer. Through it, we can measure how feverish our planet is. In 2022, we will take an expedition of minority students from equatorial countries to conduct research in Antarctic waters. We will not only empower, but we will be inspired by their knowledge and learn from it, as they have in fact experienced firsthand the impacts of climate change. We need to provide resources to underrepresented students. We need to reface research and rethink conservation. Solutions can only be viable if everyone is part of them. Our mission at the Shackleton Research Trust is to provide these resources and make sure nobody is left behind.